Dear students, in the previous video class, we have learnt about the important agricultural practices. In that, we have learnt in detail about the first two agricultural practices, that is preparation of soil and sowing. In today's class, let us learn about adding manure and fertilizer, the third important step under agricultural practice. As we all know that, the substances which are added to the soil in the form of nutrients for the healthy growth of plants are called manure and fertilizers. Soil supplies minerals, nutrients to the crop plant. We can see in this picture, soil is a rich source of nutrients to the plant. It supplies both micronutrients and macronutrients to the plant. Nutrients are essential for the growth of plants, but in certain areas, farmers grow crop after crop in the same field. The field is never left uncultivated or fallow. Imagine what happens. This is what happens there. If the farmer is continuously growing the crop in the field, then the soil becomes infertile and it will lose all the nutrients. So here in this image, you can see the land which is left fallow or uncultivated and land which was continuously being used by the farmer. So it is no more, it is not having any more nutrients left here and the soil is becoming infertile and it has lost the nutrients. But here, since the land is left fallow or uncultivated for the particular seasons, therefore it has all the important nutrients and the soil is fertile. As we know that continuous cultivation of crops makes the soil poor in nutrients. Therefore, farmers have to add manure to the field to replenish the soil with nutrients. Such a process of adding manure to the field is termed as manuring. Here you can see in this picture, farmer is preparing manure and he is adding manure to the field. Improper or insufficient manuring results in weak plants. In this picture, you can see that plants also require important minerals like boron, sulfur, manganese, zinc, magnesium, phosphorus, calcium, iron, copper, molybdenum, potassium, and nitrogen. So, what happens if this, you can see here in this picture, you can easily identify if zinc is not supplied properly, then it results in spots on the leaf. If iron is not supplied, then the leaf will be discolored. In the same way, if nitrogen is not supplied properly, it will result in poor growth, leaf become pale green or yellow because they are unable to make sufficient chlorophyll. Here you can see I am moving the cursor. Here, since nitrogen is not supplied, if nitrogen is not supplied in correct amount to the plant, then it becomes pale yellow and it will turn yellow because it is not having sufficient nitrogen to prepare to make sufficient chlorophyll. In the same way, potassium, if potassium is not supplied in a proper amount, then it results in chlorosis or yellowing. Yellowing at the leaf margin. Here you can see the leaf margin turns yellow and it results in necrosis or death of the leaf. Simultaneously, if phosphorus is not supplied in a proper proportion, then you can see dark bluish green leaves, bluish color in the leaves, and the leaf become purplish. Manure is an organic substance obtained from the decomposition of plant or animal waste. Farmers dump plant and animal waste in pits or at open places and allow it to decompose. The decomposition is caused by some microorganisms. The decomposed matter is used as organic manure. Dear children, you all have learnt about vermicomposting in your previous class. Vermicomposting is the method of making of compost by using redworms or earthworms. We know that by making different layers of soil and organic matter, using this earthworm, we can convert this organic matter into a compost. So this process is called as vermicomposting. It is rich in plant nutrients. Let us take one simple activity. So what you have to do in this activity is take 3 glasses equal volume, then collect some green grams and take equal amount of grams and take equal amount of soil, equal number of grams, and sow the grams into this glasses, 3 glasses. The first glass, you should add cow dung to the first glass, which is marked as A. To the second glass B, which is marked as B, you should add some fertilizer like urea. And to the third glass, you should not add anything. So keep this 3 glasses for some days, about 7 to 10 days, and make your observation. Let us learn what is fertilizers. Fertilizers are chemical substances that are rich in particular nutrient. Fertilizers are different from manure. These fertilizers are produced in factories. Example of fertilizers are urea, ammonium sulfate, superphosphate, potash, NPK, etc. Here you can see in this picture, the farmer is applying fertilizer to his field. The use of fertilizers has helped farmer to get better yield of crops such as wheat, paddy and maize. But excessive use of fertilizers had made the soil less fertile. If the farmer is continuously using the fertilizers and if he is using it in excess, then the field becomes unfertile. And it also results, excessive fertilizer usage of fertilizers results in fertilizer burn. You can see browny blackish patches on the leaves, which is due to excessive use of fertilizer. And we know that fertilizers have also become a source of water pollution. Therefore, in order to maintain the fertility of soil, we have to substitute fertilizer by some good organic manure. Or one more option is leave the field uncultivated. We can do some animal sitting on the field also. So here in this picture you can see fertilizers, the water pollution and algal bloom has resulted due to excessive use of fertilizers in the surrounding agricultural fields. Let us learn some effects of fertilizers. Fertilizers effect on soil. Fertilizers have effect on water. Fertilizers affect atmosphere. And it also affects food quality. It affects the human health and cattle. It also affects the quality of the crops. What are the effects of fertilizer on soil? If these fertilizers are excessively applied to the soil, it results in infertile soil. It decreases the acidic pH of the soil and it results in acidic soil. And it increases particular type of microorganisms. It results in salt burns. Groundwater pollution, it leads to groundwater pollution and excessive growth of alga. The use of manure improves soil texture. You can see in this picture, the soil is having rich texture and it also has a good water retaining capacity. The soil will be moist and it will have rich water retaining capacity. And it also replenishes the soil with important nutrients. We know that another one method which we can follow to stop the soil infertility of soil or to get a good yield is crop rotation. So crop rotation also replenishes soil nutrients. Crop rotation is done by growing different crops in the same by growing different crops alternately in the same field. Earlier, farmers in northern India used to grow legumes as fodder in one season and wheat in the next season. This helped in the replenishment of the soil with nitrogen. Farmers are being encouraged to adopt this process or this practice of crop rotation. Rotation of crops. In one season, grow one type of crop. In the next season, we need to grow other type of crop. Or if we are growing in one season, if cereals are grown, in the next season, pulses must be grown. Soil fertility can be replenished by growing legumes, leguminous plants. We know that rhizobium bacteria flourish well in the root nodules of leguminous plants. Here in this picture you can see this is the bacteria, rhizobium bacteria. It flourishes, it makes a habitat, its habitat, microhabitat inside the roots of leguminous plants. And in return it supplies nitrogen to the plant. So it helps in fixing atmospheric nitrogen. So if this type of leguminous plants are grown in the field, then the soil will be rich in nitrogen. Manure versus fertilizer. Let us learn the difference between manure and fertilizer. Fertilizer is inorganic salt. It is a chemical substance. Manure is a natural organic substance. Since manure is obtained by using plant and animal waste, it is a natural substance and organic substance. Fertilizer is prepared in factories by using chemicals, whereas manure is prepared in fields, in the pits, and by using a natural organic substance. Fertilizer does not humidify the soil, whereas manure provides humus to the soil. Fertilizer does not increase the moisture content in the soil, whereas manure helps in more moisture retaining, increases the moisture retaining capacity of the soil. Fertilizers are rich in particular plant nutrient, whereas manure is less rich in plant nutrient, but it is not harmful. It is very good for the health of the plant and also for the human and animal. Advantages of manuring. Manuring improves water retaining capacity of the soil. It makes the soil porous. Microorganisms and earthworms can grow well, and it also helps in exchange of gases. By using manure, the content of friendly microbes can be increased in the soil. It also improves the texture of the soil and it replenishes the soil with necessary nutrients. Let us move on for the next practice, very important practice, that is irrigation. We know that all living beings need water to live. Water is important for the proper growth and development. Water is absorbed by the plant roots. Along with water, minerals and fertilizers are also absorbed. Plants contain nearly 90% water. Water is essential because germination of seeds does not take place under dry conditions. Nutrients dissolved in water are transported to each part of the plant. Water also protects the crop from both frost and hot air currents. To maintain the moisture of the soil for healthy crop growth, fields have to be watered regularly. Irrigation. So to supply water regularly to the field, we follow irrigation. So what is irrigation? The supply of water to crops at regular intervals is called irrigation. The different sources of irrigation are wells, tube wells, ponds, lakes, rivers, dams and canals. So here are the methods of irrigation, traditional and modern. In this picture, you can see in this chart, you can see traditional method of irrigation. Here you can see modern methods of irrigation. These are the traditional methods of irrigation. To name it, the traditional methods of irrigation are dhekli, chain pump, mot or pulley system and Rahat liver system. These are the two modern type methods of irrigation. The first one is sprinkler system and one more is drip system. In sprinkler system, water is supplied using the pipe-like structure, and water flows in this pipe at high pressure and gets sprinkled on the crops. So this method is useful in irrigating sandy soil. And this, in this picture you can see, this is drip irrigation system. Here water falls drop by drop on the position of roots. These are the two methods, modern methods of irrigation. Let us recall once again methods of irrigation, traditional and modern. So under traditional system, we have seen four types, that is mot or pulley, chain pump system, dhekli system and rahat system. In modern, we have seen sprinkler system and drip system. Let us learn more about this. In this picture, you can see this is the traditional method of irrigation. Here you can see farmer is using mot system or pulley system to pull the water, and he is supplying the water to the crop. This is the chain pump system. Here you can see the chain and pump. With the help of chain and pump, the water is collected from this lane and it is supplied to the crop field. So this type of system of supplying water is called chain pump system. This is one more method. Here the farmer is tying a heavy load at one end and is tying a water collector at the other end. So whenever he moves this with the help of this load, as he brings it down, the water gets collected from the well and the farmer can easily supply water to the field. So such a type of system is called as dhekli system. And here rahat system. This is a system wherein, with the help of animals, the lever is rotated and simultaneously this wheel rotates and it collects the water from one end and it supplies to the lane which is present at other end, and it is channelized to the agricultural field. We all know that irrigation is the supply of water to crops at regular intervals. Can you identify which type of irrigation is this? This is the modern method of irrigation. As we can see here, the water is getting sprinkled. This is the sprinkler system of irrigation. Again, you can see one more picture where the water is sprinkled on the field. Water efficient sprinkler nozzles are used to sprinkle water all over the crop field. So water is sprinkled here. So this type of irrigation system is called sprinkler system. Here again, the water, it is seen to it that the water gets supplied to each and every area 360 degree, and it is using a ring system here to supply water to overall agricultural field. Again, the water which is coming with a force is disturbed there with the help of a knob which is helping the water which is oozing out with a force to get sprinkled all over. The sprinkler is present which is helping in sprinkling the water. So, till now we have seen the different sprinkler system of irrigation. Now, this is another one system of modern system of irrigation, drip irrigation. Here you can see the water is reaching the crop drop by drop, reaching the roots of the crop in drops. Since the water is supplied to the agricultural field drip by drip or drop by drop, such a type of system is called as drip irrigation. Here you can see the water is reaching the root level of the crop drop wise. So this is one of the efficient method of irrigation since there is no loss of water. Now the next agricultural practice is protecting from weeds. Dear children, we all know that sometime if there is a paddy field, in that paddy field we get unwanted plants. We can notice some of the unwanted plants like parthenium or grass, etc. So these unwanted plants are called as weeds. Many other undesirable plants may grow naturally along with crop. So these undesirable plants are called weeds. So wheat doesn't require these weeds because it is sometimes poisonous. It may come with along with the harvesting, or it will compete with other crops. So we need to remove it. So removing of these weeds is called weeding. So what is weeding? It is a process of removal of weeds. Why we have to remove weeds? We know that weeding is necessary. Removal of weeds is necessary since weeds compete with crop plants for water, nutrients, space and light. Thus, they also affect the growth of crop. Some weeds even interfere in harvesting and may be poisonous for animals and human beings on consumption. So this has to be removed, and we call this process as weeding. So this weeding can be done manually. You can see here one farmer is removing the weeds by using this khurpi. Here again, manual removal of weeds. Unwanted plants is removed here. This process is called weeding, removing of unwanted plants. And this removal of weeds or the growth of weeds can be stopped by using weedicides. So weedicides are the chemicals that are sprayed to kill the weeds and control it. Here I have a can which contains the weedicide. So this weedicide chemical, the name of the chemical is 2,4-D ethyl ester. So this 2,4-D ethyl ester is a chemical that is used as weedicide to kill the weeds, to control the weeds. We can use this chemical. This chemical is usually diluted and it is sprayed on the crops to stop the growth of weeds. So farmer does this. Here you can see this farmer is spraying the weedicide. But here he is doing one mistake. He is not covering his face and nose. This is very dangerous. The farmer must always protect. Whenever the weedicide is sprayed, the farmer must protect his nose, protect his face while spraying the weedicide. The next process is harvesting. Agricultural, very important agricultural practice is harvesting. As you sow, that you reap. So now the farmer has done all the harvest, all the hard work, and now it is a time to get the fruit. So this is one of the important and very happy. Farmers will be very happy during the time of harvest. So let us see how this is done and what is this harvesting. The cutting of crop after it is mature is called harvesting. Now the crop field is fully green and nice, and fully we have got the crops. It is a time to harvest it. So this cutting of crop is called harvesting. This harvesting is either done manually by using sickle, or it can be done by using machine called harvester. And in this picture, you can see the farmers are cutting the crops manually by using the sickle. The device which they are using, implement which they are using there is sickle. They are cutting the crops using the sickle. And here you can see harvesting the crop. Carrot is fully grown. Now it is ready to harvest. So they are using a machine. They are harvesting the crop carrot by using the machine. So this is called harvester machine. It is also called harvester combine. Here you can see, we know that crops has a chaff. So this chaff has to be removed. The outer covering chaff has to be removed. Sometimes the machine itself separates it and it can be harvested. The chaff is also removed simultaneously. By the process called threshing, the chaff from the grain seeds are separated. Threshing is carried using the harvester combine. Chaff is also separated by winnowing. You have learnt about winnowing and threshing in your previous class. Now, the next important agricultural practice is storage. Storage of produce. Now, we know that the crop is harvested. Now, we have to store it in a proper place. Storage of produce is important task. Harvested grains should be safe from moisture, insects, rats, and microorganisms. Farmers store grain in jute bags, and this is one of the traditional system of storing the crop. Farmers also store the crop in jute bags, and we should see to it that it is well fumigated so that moisture, insects, pests should not attack it. Rats and rodents must not attack it. We should continuously fumigate this sack. And in large, if the harvest is large, if the crop is more, then the farmer can store it in a large bins, huge bins like this. It is called as silos. Dear children, in the beginning of the class, we have learnt about animal husbandry. We know that agriculture is not only a growing of crops, it is also rearing of animals. Rearing of animals is also included under agriculture. So, rearing of animals on large scale for food, milk, and other products is called animal husbandry. This animal husbandry can be learnt in four important classes, divisions. First is cattle farming, poultry farming, apiculture, and fish farming. So what is cattle farming? Rearing of cows and buffaloes for their milk is called cattle farming. Simultaneously, poultry farming is raising fowls for their eggs and meat. Poultry farming, this is also included under agriculture. Apiculture, apiary, keeping bees, honeybees for their honey and wax is called apiculture. This is also included under agriculture. Fish farming, capturing and culturing of fish for their meat is called fish farming. This is also included under agriculture. So these are the different divisions of agriculture which come under animal husbandry, which is a part of agriculture. Let us take some homework question. So here you have to make a chart to show different sources of following food. Here I have given this column, second column I have given food, milk, egg, meat and oil. What are the sources of milk? We get milk from cow, goat, she camel, etc. Isn't it? Buffalo. You need to write these sources in this row. Simultaneously, egg. We get egg from, write the names of the birds from where you get the egg. Who give you egg? Meat and oil. Simultaneously, you have to fill this column and you have to submit me the homework. Take one more important and very easy question. Match the following. Here there is a agricultural implement. Here what for it is used. Uses. So sickle, hoe, seed drill, sprinkler. What for it is used? You get the answer here. So find out the answer. Plowing, sowing, harvesting, irrigation. Match it correctly, the implement with its important process, and submit me the answers. Thank you, children. Have a nice day. If you are having any questions or queries, please do contact me. I'll be very happy to discuss with you. Thank you.